This week at NASA. During a recent visit to the Gulf Coast region, Deputy Administrator Lori Garver toured two NASA facilities that are key to development of the new space launch system and the agency's commercial crew partnerships with private industry. At the Michoud Assembly Facility in New Orleans, Garver was briefed on progress being made in support of the SLS and the Orion spacecraft programs.
Michoud is a crown jewel at NASA, helping to really expand our reach into the solar system. NASA's all about doing things that we've never done before. And we truly know that the people here know how to do that. Your history with NASA, from Apollo through the shuttle program now to SLS and Orion, is something that we treasure.
Garver later traveled to Stennis Space Center in Bay St. Louis, Mississippi for a tour of testing facilities there, including the B-2 test stand. Once used to test Apollo-era engines, the structure is being restored to prepare it for testing of the SLS core stage. The Expedition 3637 crew, Soyuz Commander Fyodor Yurchikhin, NASA Flight Engineer Karen Nyberg, and Flight Engineer Luca Parmitano of the European Space Agency is training at the Gagarin Cosmonaut Training Center in Star City, Russia, in preparation for its upcoming trip to the International Space Station. Training activities include familiarizing themselves with systems of a Soyuz spacecraft like the one that'll take them to the station. The trio is scheduled to travel from Star City to the launch site at the Baikonur Cosmodrome in Kazakhstan on May 16th to complete training. Launch is scheduled for May 29th local time. The Mars exploration rover Opportunity has executed a sequence of commands from the ground and has resumed normal operations, confirming it is back under control of the rover team. During a recent moratorium on commanding while Mars passed nearly behind the Sun, a phase called solar conjunction, Opportunity entered a type of standby mode, presumably because it was awaiting instructions from the ground. Meanwhile, Curiosity, the most recent rover on the red planet, has also reported coming through the conjunction in full health. NASA's newest scientific rover will roam the icy landscape in Greenland to help scientists better understand changes in the massive ice sheet and the impact those changes have on sea level rise. The autonomous solar-powered robot named Grover, which stands for both Greenland Rover and Goddard Remotely Operated Vehicle for Exploration and Research, uses a ground-penetrating radar to collect data on snow accumulation and ice sheet buildup. This data is typically gathered by people on snowmobiles and airplanes, but Grover's ability to work longer hours than humans promises to increase the amount of information available to researchers. The rover trials are scheduled to run through June 8th.
And we're going to do that by getting a sample from this asteroid and bringing it back to Earth for detailed analysis.
A public presentation at NASA headquarters provided an overview of OSIRIS-REx, a NASA mission that will send a robotic probe to an asteroid in September 2016 to collect and return a sample of that asteroid to Earth. In the presentation, Asteroids Coming to Earth, principal investigator Dr. Dante Loretta discussed the mission.
Asteroids represent a great opportunity. These are resources in near-Earth space. We're talking about water, organic material, precious metals that we're going to need if we're serious about expanding the human presence beyond the Earth-Moon system.
Previously known as 1999 RQ-36, the target asteroid's new name, submitted by a North Carolina third grader to an international naming contest, is Bennu, a mythological Egyptian bird. Also at the presentation, samples of meteorites, including a piece from the recent event in Russia. OSIRIS-REx is managed by Goddard Space Flight Center in collaboration with the University of Arizona and Lockheed Martin. NASA's Cassini spacecraft has provided the first close-up visible light views of a behemoth hurricane swirling around Saturn's North Pole. High-resolution images made possible by Cassini's current campaign of tilted orbits reveal that the hurricane's eye is about 1,250 miles wide, 20 times larger than the average hurricane eye on Earth. Thin, bright clouds at the outer edge of the storm are traveling at 330 miles per hour. The hurricane swirls inside a large, mysterious, six-sided weather pattern known as the hexagon. The Herschel Space Observatory, a European Space Agency telescope for which NASA's Jet Propulsion Laboratory helped build instruments and process data, has stopped making observations after running out of liquid coolant as expected. Launched almost 4 years ago, Herschel revealed the universe's coolest secrets by observing the frigid side of planet, star, and galaxy formation.
Herschel was able to collect data to help us understand objects in the universe that no other mission has allowed us to do. Here we are, made of carbon and nitrogen and oxygen. Where did those elements come from? And Herschel helped us connect the dots in that story.
Although observations by Herschel have ceased, astronomers will continue to examine data collected by the telescope for more clues about the secrets of the cosmos. A new video made from images taken by NASA's Solar Dynamics Observatory provides an unprecedented time-lapse look at the last 3 years of the Sun in just 30 seconds. The sequence shows the Sun in extreme ultraviolet light at a pace of one image every 12 hours. Since its launch in 2010, SDO has captured a virtually unbroken record of the Sun's activity. Operated by Goddard Space Flight Center, SDO is improving our understanding of the Sun and its effect on conditions in space and here on Earth.
Researchers at NASA Ames are using the center's 9x7-foot wind tunnel to test concept models of commercial jets that might someday fly at supersonic speeds across the country. The current work involves modifying the engine intakes and wings of potential aircraft designs to minimize the impact of sonic booms heard on the ground when planes fly faster than the speed of sound. Ames researchers and industry partners will use the data from these tests to improve computational models so that quieter aircraft designs can be developed.
The state of Alabama recognized Marshall Space Flight Center's achievements in space exploration and the center's important role in the state's economy and history during NASA Day in Alabama at the state capitol in Montgomery. Marshall Center Director Patrick Sherman and astronauts Kate Rubens and Jack Fisher were on hand to meet Governor Robert Bentley. The event also included displays and information about Marshall's lead role in development of NASA's Space Launch System, as well as the center's contributions to expanding research aboard the International Space Station. On May 5, 1961, Mercury astronaut Alan Shepard launched aboard his Freedom 7 spacecraft from Cape Canaveral, making him the first American in space. Shepard's historic flight came 3 weeks after Russian cosmonaut Yuri Gagarin became the first human in space. Shepard's suborbital flight reached an altitude of 116 miles and lasted about 15 minutes. After traveling just over 300 miles, Shepard and Freedom 7 splashed down safely in the Atlantic Ocean. And that's This Week in NASA. For more on these and other stories, or to follow us on Ustream, Flickr, and other social media, log on to www.nasa.gov.